Hello.
Hello, Sergio.
Good. Nice. How are you?
Good. Nice to see you. How are you doing?
Good. Where are you?
I'm in Greensboro, North Carolina. So I really enjoyed the documentary, but I had to wonder, what's it like for you to see your, 60 plus years of your life condensed into 60 minutes?
It was a great experience working with John Scheinfeld. He produced and directed, and we worked 2 years on it. We went to Brazil. He interviewed a lot of people, and I didn't see any of the interviews. I would come back on the end of it because I wanted to see the film finish, the whole hour and a half. And it was very emotional when I saw the whole thing that he put together and produced, and it was great.
Yeah, so I thought it came out really well. One of the things that really struck me from your early days, so you speak of feeling this saudade for the early days when you and your friends, you were all into American jazz and foreign films. And, I felt a sense of saudade. I wasn't even there. And it was like, man, that sounds so cool.
Yes.
Can you tell me a little more about that period?
Yeah. I mean, they say I was like around between 14 and 18 years old. And we're living in this small town called Niterói, across the bay from Rio. And in those days that you had to take a boat to travel, which used to take 45 minutes. So Rio was already something far away. Right. And so you can imagine for us to be listening to, Coltrane and Charlie Parker and Art Tatum and watching Fellini movies and talking about, talking about, I wrote this song for Gauguin called Noah Noah. So we're living kind of a bohemian tropical Paris 1930s live in Rio, in Niterói. Right. So that was our world, it was all of that combination of literature, jazz and art. It was very nice. So small group of people, but that's how that's how I got introduced to jazz, for instance. So it was a very, very good moment. And then Bossa Nova came in, and it was a great moment.
So much of the early Bossa Nova was so gentle and soft, and yet so much of your music really brought this kind of new sense of power and drive to it. How did that come about? Was that through the jams at the Bottles Bar?
So during the Bossa Nova days, like you said, was most of the songs were very minimalist, meaning not the songs itself, but it was a guitar and a singer.
Right.
And, but fantastic melodies, was great harmonies. And I mean, so hip. It was so hip that it fascinated all jazz musicians in America.
Right.
And I'm talking about the music mostly of Antonio Carlos Jobim. He was a genius. He was like a, Cole Porter, that kind of amazing songwriter. And those melodies, they seduce, Stan Getz and Dizzy Gillespie and Sinatra and so many others. And so at the same time, I'm living down there, working in Rio and listening and surrounded by those beautiful songs. And I said, maybe I'm going to put a band that, instead of a vocal, because I'm not a singer, I'm a pianist and an arranger. So I said, I'm going to put something like in the style of the, Art Blakey and that kind of thing. So two trombones and tenor saxophone and drums. And so the thing was very, I don't know the word, but was the opposite of the minimalist guitar and vocal. And I love that sound, and people did too, because it was such a different thing from the guitar voice singer composer thing. But it was a wonderful time. And we came to Carnegie Hall in 62 for the Bossa Nova Jazz Festival.
Right.
And it was very well received. And I was invited to do the album with Cannonball. So that's the beginning.
So what was it like going into the studio in the U.S. for the first time with Cannonball?
Oh, it was like was amazing. I was in awe, meaning like I couldn't believe that I was there with my idol and working with him. He was a gentle, wonderful person, you know, and very nice, very warm. But just, I couldn't believe it. I was pinching myself. So I'm here, you know, working with Cannonball. It's not possible. I'm like 21 years old. And so all of those things, you know, I mentioned the word serendipity in the few times in right. the documentary. And I think it describes pretty much those encounters for me.
Yeah, I mean, it's so, I think that's such an accurate way of putting it. I mean, just like, for instance, the idea that you and Lani Hall connect in yes. a club in Old Town Chicago, which, yeah. you know, on your last night of the gig.
That's correct, yeah. She was like singing, folk singing, you know, and but I love her voice and the sound. It was another great serendipity moment. And she became, you know, the main sound of Brazil 66.
So what was it like being on A&M Records in the late 60s? I mean, I have this image of it as this sort of golden time to make records in Hollywood, but especially for that label.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the fact that, you know, they were just starting. You know, Herb had a big success with the Tijuana Brass, so they're starting a label. And for me, being part of that was so good. I mean, total artistic freedom, just band record whatever you want, and, you know, no kind of people telling you what to do. And so it was a great. Then when I came back to A&M, the first song I recorded was Never Gonna Let You Go, was a male vocalist, which was like something that, what is that? What is the Brazil 66 sound? I said, no, I'm trying something different, you know, that kind of curiosity and I guess some courage.
Right, yeah, no fear about trying new things.
Absolutely, always.
So getting back to that Brazil 66 sound though, I mean, how did you hit upon that sort of unison, double female vocal sound?
You know, it's all by, you know, it's like not something that I had planned in my head or anything like that. We start rehearsing here in LA, and there was a Brazilian girl in town and Lani, and we start singing the songs that I used to play in the Bottles Bar, you know, most of the Jobim songs and some others. And when they start singing together, just very simple sound, you know, I love that sound, the texture very much. You know, I remember in the past, I had the two trombones and so I kind of like, I felt, oh man, that's so sensual and simple. And so I said, yeah, that's great. So I kept that as kind of a trademark kind of thing. You know, because it just felt right. Was a lot of intuition also, you know. So a little magical, but great.
Right. Well, one of my favorite tracks that you recorded was your version of Edu Lobo's Crystal Illusions.
Oh, yeah. Great song.
Great song.
And before that, we had Upa Neguinho, which is also, he wrote.
Right.
And which is also, you know, up-tempo and kind of a northeastern Brazil kind of sounds. And yeah, Crystal Illusions, I remember that. Yeah, great.
But it's, you know, unlike a lot of the other songs you recorded around that time, it's you know, it's longer, it's almost 8 minutes, and it almost has kind of a trippy psychedelic feel to it.
Maybe. I think that had to do with the great, was another component of my records in those days, was the orchestration of Dave Grusin. Because he wrote some incredible arrangements, and I would finish a track and he would come and listen to the track, and then you put the horns and the strings and bring that almost like a cinematographical kind of thing for the song, you know. So, you know, in all those songs at the time, you know, The Look of Love, and Dave Grusin had an incredible contribution on that collaboration with his so unique arrangements.
Right. So I mean, with your own arrangements, you know, you obviously have a talent for taking other people's songs and kind of putting your own spin on them.
Uh-huh.
Where did that come from? I mean, how did you become so good at that?
I think came from starting me not being a composer at the beginning. I mean, I wrote songs after that, but just being a, you know, at the Bottles Bar in Rio, Bossa Nova, I was a pianist, arranger, producer. So my function was really arranging, putting sounds together and being a piano player and organizing that sound. So that was really my function. And the fact that, you know, I like so much melodies and I was an interpreter of people's songs. I mean, you know, I was playing songs from Henry Mancini, Gershwin, Cole Porter, Jobim. And I think that as an arranger pianist, that's what I love doing it, you know, a lot.
Right.
Fool on the Hill, I heard it. I was spending a New Year's with Herb in Acapulco, and I heard the Magical Mystery Tour record, and I said, man, what an incredible melody, and I want to make a Brazilian arrangement for that, a samba in 3-4 and so forth, and we went to the studio, and boom, you know, it just happened, but it's right. Part of it.
But I just got to say, the image of you and Herb hanging out in Acapulco, listening to Magical Mystery Tour, that's a great image.
That's right. Wow, you're kidding? Yeah. And then I hear that album. I said, man, what an incredible melody. And years later, I got a letter from Paul McCartney saying that was his favorite version of his song.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I was going to ask you if you, because you've recorded a lot of his songs. So that's the, back to Tomasz Granata for a second. I mean, when that hit, that was the first big international hit in Portuguese. And I wondered, in Brazil, did people appreciate that you were bringing Brazilian music to the international pop charts, or was there any kind of backlash? Like,
it was a big hit in Brazil too. Oh yeah. But you know, it's always gonna be people that say, well, you know, it's not really that or that, but that's part of, it's part of life. But no, that was a big hit in Brazil. That was a big hit in Brazil in 66, and it was a big hit again, Brazil and all over the world, in Japan, the Philippines, in Europe, in France, and everywhere. And then 40 years later, when I did the version of the Black Eyed Peas, became a big hit, and that was a big success again.
So going back a little bit, what was it like? You collaborated with Stevie Wonder back in the 70s. What was that like?
Amazing. I met him and he told me how much he loved Brazilian music and Brazil 66. And he played songs like he loved Você Abusou. He loved, what was his favorite? Was Pretty World. And he'd sit down and play beautifully, of course. So we became friends. And he asked me to write a lyric in Portuguese for him, which I did, this song called Birdie of Beauty.
Right.
And he recorded a few verses in Portuguese because he wanted, you know, he's like very curious. He always wanted to try different things. And he presented me with a gold record for doing that. And we became friends. And in those days, we saw each other a lot. He would finish a recording, would come to my house. My wife would cook Brazilian food for him. And he's a genius. For me, it's one of the most incredible musicians of all time. He wrote a song for me. He had the real thing.
Right.
And he said, oh, I got this for you. It's just amazing. It was just,
so the real thing he wrote specifically for you?
Specifically for me, yeah. Having the vocals, yeah.
Well, last question for you. We talked about the word serendipity coming up in the documentary a lot. There's another word that seems to come up a lot, which is joy. And obviously serendipity, that's out of your hands, but joy, that's something you have a little more control over, or at least in terms of putting into your music. I mean, I wondered, how do you translate that joy into music, and how important is that for your music?
Well, the first translation is to Portuguese, the word alegria, such an important component, element of Brazilian music. dancing on the streets and carnival and you know, happy. It's happy people and it's festive and people like to celebrate. So alegria is part of our culture, very much. It's in the rhythms. It's in the, that doesn't mean, you know, that they're incredible sad songs too. But I think alegria is a big component on Brazilian music. And I love the word, you know. But it's part of music. I mean, I think when you play, you do a concert, I mean, when you have an audience out there, I think you're giving them alegria, you know. Right. And I think it's such a great feeling.
That kind of exchange of energy.
Yes.
That's excellent. Well, Sérgio, thank you so much for taking the time to do this. Your music has brought me a lot of joy as well. And it's an honor to talk to you.
It's a pleasure. Nice meeting you too.
Excellent. Take care of yourself and hope to see you out there.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.